Cambodia is organizing a series of interviews which we call the Exporter Stories Interviews, where we seek to understand the challenges faced by exporting companies, and also especially to get to know the story behind how the company first started, or the lessons that I'd like to share to other companies that are looking to export their products as well. Today we're fortunate to have AgriHouse in our meeting. Please introduce yourself and the company.
Thank you. So my name is Ming Sok, you can call me Joe. I'm Food Technologies at Cricket House, which is now registered as AgriHouse, which means Cricket House is under AgriHouse, but we're still here. And without the company, AgriHouse, we work to create income for disability people and the marginalized community. And by that, we introduce technology to them and then bring the markets for their income. And a bit of Cricket House, we got a great news now because we recently got funds from World Food Program grants. And for that, we are going to develop a new nutritious snack for school age children. And in a few months, we are going to announce something great. Thank you.
That sounds interesting. Can you tell me what inspired this business idea?
Well, I'm pretty new to the company, but I feel they're passionate in that. So first, they started to look on the poverty of people in the country, and then they found out that our farmers, especially those who produce rice, they have only one income in a year, which is during the harvesting time. And then at the moment, there's also the cricket markets, like the huge demands, and it was really popular during that time. They started the markets, and then they got the idea to find a new way to create the second income for the people. And also another thing is, the reason why we work with cricket, it's also because the inspiration from our food culture. And as you know, like in Southeast Asia, it's not just in Cambodia, Thailand, and Vietnam, like eating crickets or grasshopper is really popular. So that's why we were like, oh, well, promote the food culture, right? And the technology in that is that, not so much, but we're trying to do more, so we convert our technique deep-frying crickets, and then we use air fry, which means the crickets that we produce, they contain less fat and oil, so that's more healthy for people.
As a food technologist yourself, can you, like, do you find significant differences between each species? Or, for example, for crickets, they offer different nutritional value compared to grasshoppers?
Okay, so there is slightly but also huge difference between grasshopper and cricket as well. For example, grasshopper will contain more protein in there, and it's less allergy in there as well. But it's like the research is still ongoing right now. It's like to confirm that it's still limited. But at the moment, after having the stick, which is now we call the house cricket, or we call the red cricket. It's approved in this year, in February, by the European Food Safety Authority, so making it safe for people to consume. So that's why more of like food production is from the US food technologies. We are more interested in that because we have enough scientific to support that it's safe for human consumption. Okay, I would like to add as well, like compared to the protein in there, it's like because they came from the same species, so that's why they are like, let's say we people, we are protein, so the same genetic and blah blah blah, and more research into the deep of nutritious and variables. When you heard about edible insects, what comes to our mind is that, oh, they contain a lot of protein, right? Yes, that's it, like 60% or something. But it also depends on the age of the cricket as well. For example, the baby, they contain less, but when they become adult, they contain more, and then when they become old, they can contain less or not, and it's also depend on the feeding as well. So that's a lot to say, maybe.
In Cricket House, as most people know, you have cricket powder.
Yeah, right? There are proteins, yeah, cricket protein powder.
Right, so how did this idea come to light? Like, why cricket?
Why we chose cricket?
Yeah, why you chose cricket?
Okay, not why I chose, but why we chose cricket. To say about that, as I mentioned before, it's also inspired huge inspiration from food culture. We saw tricks in there. And personally, I studied in Hungary. And in there, during an assignment where we have to show the shocking culture in food, and I found that people there, they find it's really disgusting to eat, like more insects. So I gave them a presentation of how I ate insects there. And for me, because I have a background doing research with food consumption there, so that's why I find it's really interesting. Like, okay, you find it disgusting, I think you eat it in the future, right? But for us in Cambodia, what we see is that actually we are not the first to do this kind of food production or cricket selling, right? But we are the Cambodian lead. Let's say we are probably the first to do that because everyone's there is have a passion again. And we see that the opportunity is in Cambodia, we haven't had, let's say, a company that represents a cricket business or someone like the company that produces cricket and then make into food production, by Cambodian people just yet. So that's why we see that's a key opportunity for us to be the first. And our goal is actually to be the first producer of this alternative cricket protein as well.
So are you currently exporting to other countries as well?
We have just a few experience with exporting. We have sent the Sunny cricket, the snack, to South Korea. And by that, we have a network who are also Cambodian there, and then they sell they have a shop there, something. And then with our cricket protein powder, we have sent to, I think, in South Korea as well, in Dubai, and Japan, I have one more country, Malaysia. So they, most of them, they bought it for testing in the feed, those are into feeding. So, yeah. Into cooking and then maybe a bit of food consumption, but in case of alternative protein, the powder we also have in we use it in baking as well, so that it's mean that for example bread it contains more nutritious better protein than the normal bread.
Well, that is the end of our first part, which is the introduction part. Now we will move on to the next part, which is the opportunities and challenges. So, can you tell me what was the most challenging hurdle that your company had to overcome beginning to export the products?
I would say huge and a lot as well. One thing is that why it's a lot because let's say we are really small, we have just started in 2019, but we start for 6 months and then after the pandemic come, so it was a lot of work for us as well. And in case of exporting, I think the most challenges are the middle one is probably the overcompeting, the overconfidence, the competing to access into the international market, right? So I think first, as now we are trying our best to obtain the export certification so that we can extend our product, but we want to focus more the first on the cricket powder because it's there's a lot of market opportunity there and as well around the world, as well as the flexibility of this kind of product that can use in a lot of things in daily life as well, especially for health. And I think another thing is that because now we are working to access into the international demand market demands, so that's why we are working to obtain the HACCP and as well the rest of the export certification.
Other factors like finding a buyer or having to comply with the exporting requirements of the other countries or the countries that you want to export the products to, and also having to meet with the logistics requirement or even finding a logistics company and things like that. What are these things, the challenges for your company as well?
the challenge is your challenge, right? And as you say, it's finding a buyer is really difficult. Why? Because now it's everywhere, every country produces this kind of business. And as we are the, let's say, news, and we start the journey from the scratch, and then it's like whole journey in there. And I think like the barrier is really, really hard for us because we have to connect to other country, and we don't really. I mean, we have network there, but the logistic behind that is that okay, what product do we have right now? It's produced made in Cambodia, right? Mm-hmm. But critical, tricky behind the business that we are facing is a bit of like difficulty is that because cricket product after human consumption, it fell under the global food, or we call it like alternative protein. So the food regulations for us to like to prove, it's really difficult because we don't really have that food regulations based in Cambodia just yet. And researching can as well prove that we have to say, okay, so this is made in Cambodia, and then it's produced, it's approved by Cambodians food regulator. So it's still like really hard for us as we don't really have much resource there. So we need more of, how to say, scientific study based in Cambodia, because most of the cricket as a food for human consumption research, which is said online, they are based more in Thailand, in Vietnam, and something like that, so it can prove that their product is, like, how to say, like, popular and waterproof. But for us, well, maybe we are neighbor of them, but we don't really have that. It's our own, like from Cambodia, so it's the most like challenge for us as well. And a bit of that, I think because of this, so that's why I have the commitment to do my master, specifically focus on this matter, so that we improve. I mean, I improve, and not just me, maybe in the future more students. For those who are like passionate about this, because for me, cricket as a food, it's like it's really sustainable, right? Because like you can produce the same amount of proteins compared to the red meat faster, and then you use less lands, and then the resource water and there. So that's why it's like, and then from years ago, let's say centuries ago, it's been practicing in our country. You see it everywhere, right? Why don't we make it like into something innovative, that means, you know, not just us get money, but also we can help the second income for the farmer as well. So that is our, how to say, main motivation to continue making the travel best of breeding.
You mentioned earlier that your company is in the process of applying for export certifications.
We are ongoing, yeah, right now.
What would you say the most challenging thing that you have to deal with in terms of, you know, in the process of applying for a certain certification, let's say?
It's a huge part to mention. The first thing came to my mind is, of course, the finance behind that, like the expense, right? Because let's say now we have our product, but we need to gain the certifications, and instead we are a bit big because we want to gain the HACCP, which is like recognized internationally, and by that the process is not easy, as we have to like prove from the scratch each of our products with your kids, and like the breeding process, the whole processing, the machine in there, our location site in there, and then it's not like how to say, it's not simple.
Yeah.
So we have to work not just me, not just my team, but the whole team, and as well the third party, those who are like the certifying bodies that we have to choose as well. So that's, I think it's cover all the challenges in there, but probably like, how to say, let's say the question, where to start? That was the most challenging for us, right? Because we were like, okay, we should go there, we can go here, we can go here. The food is like an expert for alternative protein. It's still like, it's really limited for us to reach out to them. So I think, I hope that covered the question.
Oh, wow, that's the end of our second plan, the opportunities and challenges plan. Next, we will move on to the most important part of this interview, which is the lessons learned. You mentioned earlier that the financial part is arguably the most important part of the process of applying for for certification. Mm-hmm. At the moment, do you have any financial assistance from any country at all?
But another point I just want to mention is like regarding to this, because right now AgriHouse, we are working and thanks to this funding support from Australia, so that's why we are running and still ongoing until nowadays. And yes, we are still trying to look for more support, and in case perfectly probably the partner firms from the third country, let's say. From the country that we are aiming to export our products, so that's we are still looking for.
In terms of exporting your products, right? What value do you see exporting your products internationally?
Well, the value right now is probably the cricket powder, because it underpins our business model and as well for the powders. Market extends as we are planning to like anchor international market, mm-hmm. and the cricket powder is like the main ingredient of our future product, because like this kind of food innovation from such edible insects is that mainly the ingredient in there is contain edible insects, right? So the powder is like mostly used in any kind of product, but it says like, oh, this product, food product, it contains edible insects. Mm-hmm. So that's why we are aiming to like promote it and then develop the technology behind us the best as we could, and then for further planning.
Mm-hmm. Let's put it this way: do you see that after exporting the products, do you see a difference, you know, in terms of before exporting your products internationally and after exporting your products? Do you see a big difference there?
Oh, it's a huge success for us in that case. Because it's not just our product, but it's also like the branding there. Because we're proud to say, oh, it's made in Cambodia. And it's like, how to say, alternative, we would say in this way it's really cool, like alternative food product from Cambodia. It is made from insects, cricket. So to us, let's say, I mean, if we like in the future get success with this, it's going to be a huge crowd for us, and as well the how to say the convenience or how to say it's gonna make us really easy in the future in case we want to develop any kind of other innovative food product or any technology that we use this. Powder as the main, how to say, ingredient in there. Yeah. So now because we are like, how to say, not yet, right? So we are still working on, but when we are yet there, like the yet is like the coming yes. So first it's like, okay, our brand is not just domestic, but it's also international. We are aiming to provide for the market demands, not just let's say in Europe, but also in other continents as well. Yeah. So yeah, my mate.
So throughout the experience that you gain, you know, from exporting your products to international markets and things like that, are there any lessons that you would share, would like to share to other companies who are looking to export their products as well?
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's say we are not a senior yet, we're still a baby as well, but what I can share is probably the working behind where we are today. As I mentioned, cricket health, we started 6 months, everything was well, and then the pandemic came, and we suddenly switched to remote work, so by that it was really challenging, even I wasn't there, but I could understand, because suddenly you have to work from home, right? And remote work is like, Some of our colleagues, it's like their first life experience, right? So I like how we help each other. We try to support each other and then teach them and share whatever we could, right? And try to keep the work going on there. And regarding to sports matter, it's probably like try to sneak in any opportunity as much as you can, even if it's like a really small chance. Try to catch it, like. Involve yourself, fit in there, because it's really challenging, and the more you try, the more you will gain experience regarding to that. I hope that answers your question.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds good. So I think today we've learned a lot of lessons from Ms. Sokneang in terms of the challenges, or some people, I mean, all the challenges that she shared probably could resonate with most of the exporting companies, because I don't think that the challenges will be that drastically different from each other. But we've noticed some important lessons that she mentioned. For example, the opportunities that you see in terms of market entering and things like that, if we don't know it wrong, try to make use of any small opportunities that you see and things like that. So, well, that is the end of today's interview. Thank you very much for making the time to be with us today. And I wish you and your company well and all the success.
Thank you.